no border. It's a smart chemical. But next up, we have a woman who has been fighting for Aboriginal and First Nation rights for a long time, and a strong partner behind one of the strong men in one of our communities from Hunkpapa. And we know that without her, Mike wouldn't be Mike. So we want to call up Suzanne Plain to come to the mic and share a few words with us this afternoon.
I guess that shows how old I am. We were smaller. In my time, people were small. Today they're getting bigger. Bonjour.
Bonjour.
Upon the water. In the teachings, it says that in the four directions, a man, the red, yellow, white, black, I didn't put them in order because I'm nervous. I'm not used to speaking too often, but getting there. We all were born with duties to this Mother Earth. And as time went by, we have forgotten what our duties are. And we were working together at one point, but now we're not. We as women, it doesn't matter, as far as I'm concerned, it doesn't matter what race you are, we are the keepers of the water. We are the ones that are supposed to be looking after that, fighting for that water. Waters are her life force. And those waters give life to every living thing. We as women also carry that water within our bodies. 80% of our body is made up of water. That is more than what the men carry. We are life givers of our children. So therefore, that's what makes us closer to Mother Earth than what the men are. That is one of the reasons why, and the main reason why, it is up to us as women to look after that water. So as a woman, I'm speaking that we need to stop the industries. We need to come together, all races need to come together to stop these industries from polluting our waters. Because we're not just hurting ourselves, this is for everybody. We're hurting our youth. We're not going to have any youth if it keeps continuing on the way it is. And where are we going to be? We'll be all gone. There's not going to be one single First Nation people left. There's not going to be any four directional colors left. And not only that, we need to look after Mother Earth for those that can't speak for themselves. Birds. They're here to protect us, to guide us. They're here to feed us. And they ask nothing from us except respect. We need to speak out for them also and look after them. care of Mother Earth. I have been living on Amjanan for 15 years with my husband, who I highly respect. He's an elder of Amjanan. He's taught me a lot, and his father, Frank Plain, has taught me very much. The lodge people have taught me. I have many teachers. I don't have one singular particular mentor. I look at everybody I come across as a mentor. And everybody that crosses my path, I am there to help. Because that is the way it is supposed to be. There is people who are put in the way. There was a ethanol plant that was supposed to be built right across from our band office there. I'm not bragging, but there was many of us that stood on that ground and fought to keep that plant from being built. It wasn't built around Amjanan, but it was built further on. I am thankful and grateful to the Creator that helped us to keep that plant from being built near the reserve, because there is so much pollution there. Our kids are sick. The elders are sick. We're losing our elders faster than I want to count. I think one year there was 8 within a matter of months. I was so sick of death at that point. I had a hard time dealing with it. I sing one of the healing songs with the drum Wingush. And the last song I sung at that time was very difficult for me to sing, because we're losing our elders, and they're the ones with the wisdom. They're the ones that pass on our cultural beliefs. They're the ones that guide us. And it hurts. It hurts so deeply that it's unbelievable. It takes the words away from me for what I feel I can't describe. There's leaks there going on right now at Sunco. The plant is shut down, but that pipeline is still leaking. And they're doing nothing about it. We've got a good amount of people here today, and I really wish there was a whole lot more, because it's going to take all directional colors to come together and stop this.
Yes.
We can't do it just with First Nation people alone. It's got to be everybody. Or we're going to lose ourselves. And it is sad that there isn't as many people as I would like to see here today.
We are here.
So we need to get the word out a lot more than what we're doing, not just on First Nation web pages, not just on First Nation Facebook pages. It needs to go out in every way we can think of. I don't know more. Exactly that. Speak out. We need to show these plants that it's got to stop.
Big watch. Well, there are some great points raised, and when it comes to solidarity, I think it's, you know, there's many groups across North America, across the world, that are working towards environmental change, bringing awareness, and it's bringing those groups together. Though, how many different groups here are represented? There's many different groups here represented, many different organizations and unions, and if we all start talking to our relatives and to our friends and to our colleagues about what we've heard here today and what we're going to do into the future, that's how we're going to create that consciousness and that awareness about where we need to go. You know, and I know that, and that's what I see here today. So yeah, but there may be very, you know, I wish there was a couple hundred more. But if we all go and tell two people, well, then that's a couple hundred more. So let's do that. Let's make that commitment that the next time we come together, we're going to bring two more with us. That we're going to bring three more with us, and that we're going to tell five more people about what's going on. So let's make that commitment together. And I want to acknowledge the next speaker here. I want to acknowledge his father, Fred Twain. He was a great, great man. When I think about him, he was a great, great leader in our community. I grew up knowing him as a young boy, and I remember listening to him. Lots in the way that he spoke and how passionate he was about his people, how much he wanted better things for his people, and how he fought for that every day of his life. And his son is here with us today, Mike Plain, and I know that he shares that same feeling, that same heart, that same drive and commitment to see change happen for his community, but also for every community. As First Nation people, we don't just care about our own. About everyone, and I know that's the same for everybody in this room here. I know you care about all people, regardless of race, regardless of religious background, and that we're all here because we have a compassionate nature. And I want to introduce this man here, Mike Plain. He's a knowledge keeper in his community. He's a knowledge keeper for all of our communities. He's a great, tremendous singer. I look up to him as a singer. You know, he's getting up there in age. I'm not going to, you know, out him. I don't want to say how old he is. You know, but he still jams. He's still jamming, you know. He's still jamming it out, you know. There's young guys that can't even keep up with him, you know. And even with all of his health, you know, health issues that he may have, he's still out here. He's still going to powwows. He's still raising his voice and helping the people. So I want to introduce this man here, Mike Plain, and give him a few moments to share a few words with us. Oh, yeah.
Seems to be in lower all the time. Must be easy this cause music and do them. Anjanan Donjava, Bezko, Mideo and Nini, Anishinaabe, Ojibwe, Lene, Lenape, and Dao. One of the things my father had told me as he was growing up, he had been brought up in the Christian way. His father, my grandfather, Nicholas, was a preacher, and he took up the Christian faith, Christian preaching. So my father followed his way, and he was also an evangelist himself. He traveled throughout the country, went down to South Carolina. He was called quite a bit down South Carolina to do some evangelistic speaking out there. This is where he was able to first start getting his speaking skills, and he kept it up until he was a dynamite speaker, and he was requested to go many, many places. Then he got into the political field. He wasn't a counselor on our territory, but he was asked to run for chief because the people there, the elders, knew of his speaking ability, and he knew how to speak to the people and be kind of like a liaison between our people and the government people. So he was asked to run for chief of our territory, and it was one of the first to be able to step up into that role without being a counselor first, and he got in by a landslide. And he was chief of our territory for about, I believe, a term and a half. And then he got called to Toronto to be the president of what they called the Union of Ontario Indians at that time. From there, he went to the north to help the people up north, because him and the northern people, the northern chiefs up there, were finding out that the governments were planning to take the resources from under their pull a bull over the eyes and take the resources from them. So he went up there and he worked with them, and he was a political analyst. He was an environmental analyst, and he really, really got them together and to make decisions and to hold back decisions that were wrong for them, as put forth by the government. As he was doing this, he was getting in touch with his Anishinaabe self, and he wanted to know more about who he was as an Anishinaabe person. And he started getting teachings from the Midewan people such as Roger Jones, Jim Dumont, Eddie Benton. And he was learning these teachings, and he was getting in touch with himself. So people were asking, well, why did you forsake the Christian ways? And he said he didn't forsake them. He says he hasn't forgotten them. He says there's good in them. He says, but the only thing is, it's not the only way. And that's what they're trying to tell me. He says it's not the only way. He says, there's our Anishinaabe way too. He said, and that's who I am. And so he started learning the teachings. And from what Bkejwanong said, you know, he's learned a lot from my father with his wisdom and from what he's done in his work, his field. But my father told me, he says, you know who my teachers are? He says, I have teachers like Roger, he says, I have teachers like Jim. He says, but when I go to the lodge, he says, and I see the children of the lodge there, he says, those are my teachers too. He says, they have a lot more knowledge about our way of life. They grew up in that lodge. They were born into that lodge. And he says, those are my teachers too. So he was learning from the children as well. And that was in our prophecy. Start to learn from our children, we would relearn who we are. So I listened to my father and I followed him around. Me and my wife drove him across Canada to these meetings. And I went to several elders' meetings with him, and I learned a lot. I learned a lot from the elders, and I learned a lot from him. It was sad to see him pass on to the spirit world, but he was sent off in a very good way, in our way, our traditional way, our way of life. And he left a legacy with his name. His name was Kakige Gobwig, one who will stand forever. And when he left, our teacher, Bodwewedon, gave me his feathers to hold. He says, you will take care of these feathers that your father has earned. He says, and you'll know what to do with them. So you'll know what to do with them when the time comes. My father had a lot of feathers. I still have quite a few of them. I've given some to my family members. But I started giving the feathers out to the youth of our community, the ones that fight for the environment. One that I just gave away just recently, she's only about 5 years old, and she goes to these environmental rallies. and she's always there, and she cries when she can't go. She really likes to go there and voice her opinions, voice her concerns. And I gave her one of those feathers. And I said, this comes from a leader of this community. I said, his name was One Who Stands Forever. I said, when this, I give you this feather, that's what it's going to mean. That's what it's going to mean to you. Because our youth are going to stand forever. They're going to fight. They're going to fight for our environment. And I see it more and more often when I go to these rallies. When we used to go to these rallies, we used to take our drum all the time to voice, because that drum calls the people. And when, and we learned a lot from the teachers of the Great Lakes drum from Northern Ontario, Roger Skeet, the Skeet family. We learned a lot from them, and they said, that's what you'll do. Says, you'll bring that. Said, you have a powerful name, Wingush, because it brings that positiveness, that happiness, that drum. Says, so carry it on, go to these rallies, help rally the people. So I carry that on today. I've been part of the environmental committee for 4 years. We can sit on that seat for 2 terms. And the one time I was there, I went to an environmental concern up in Sault Ste. Marie, I believe it was. And there was the nuclear waste management team that was looking for a place to bury their waste. And as we were gathered there, the Treaty 3 drum committee, and these were old elderly people that hold that drum. They set their drum in the middle of that conference. And that drum, looking at it, almost brought me to tears. How beautiful it was sitting there in the midst of everybody that was there. The care and the love that these elders had for that drum, adorned with the white cloth, the colorful ribbons, the eagle feathers, the poles that hold that. Those poles are the symbols of women that hold that drum together. And I looked at that drum and seen how beautiful it was, because that drum is representative of Mother Earth. So when it came time for me to say something of my concerns for this nuclear waste, I said, I want you all to look at this drum, how beautiful it is. And everybody looked at it and agreed how beautiful it was. I says, it has a beautiful sound coming from it. I says, when you beat on it, it's the heartbeat of Mother Earth, and it sounds so healthy. It sounds so beautiful. I says, and if you drill a hole into it and you put something into it that isn't agreeable to that drum, it's going to make it sound terrible. It's going to alter it. I says, if you take anything from that drum and alter it, that's what's going to happen. I said, and that's exactly what you're doing to Mother Earth. Is when you put things in there that Mother Earth does not want, or you extract things, you're going to alter that. I said, and Mother Earth is crying when you do that. So when I made that analogy of that drum there, they got the message. But it's the dollars, it's a dollar sign in their eyes that keep them going. And that's our biggest fight. That's our biggest enemy, is the dollar signs. that we have to fight with these corporations, industries, government. So when I made that analogy, everybody agreed. And the elders there thanked me for bringing that analogy up. It was always the native people that had gathered together and protested on Parliament Hill, Queen's Park, gathered there together, and it was always the rest of the Canadian public that says, oh, the natives are restless again, the natives are getting all wound up again. And I heard that time and time again. This last rally that I went to in Toronto, and one of the guys that was there is right in the back there, and his name is Zach, and a very, very good advocate for First Nations and our concerns, because it's his concern too about the pollution. We amassed there with all different colors of human beings, showing our concerns for the fracking that is going on. Because with that fracking, it's altering the earth, it's polluting our water, the same way with the tar sands. And this is what we're all standing up for, against. And it takes all of us together as one in that medicine wheel, that color spectrum of the medicine wheel, which is all human beings. It takes all of us to finally get our voices heard. And it was just an amazing sight to be at that rally there last weekend. One other thing I'd like to share is that I told people there, I said, our bodies are like the Mother Earth itself. Just as Susan said, we are comprised of the elements of Mother Earth. We have the air, water, fire, the earth within us, and all those elements that are within Mother Earth, even the copper, even the zinc, and all those minerals and everything are comprised of our bodies. And so when you extract, someone said they're going to extract some oil from you. They said they need that oil from you, and they extract it from your skin. What's going to happen? They extract that oil. You're going to dry up. You're going to dry because your body needs that oil. Now, when they extract that from Mother Earth, isn't that the same thing that they're doing? They're extracting the oil from them. They're making Mother Earth dry. She's going to start cracking up, and she's going to alter. There's going to be earthquakes, and there's going to be all these different things, you know, climate changes and everything. This is what they're doing. All for what? For money. This is what I want to share with you today. Miigwech.